7. Okay, right now it should work. And today, Anne Stark will present the final presentation of his master thesis, right? And it's about self-supervised learning for small molecular graphs. So, Anes, when you want to start, you can.
Yeah, thank you very much. That's the title of the thesis that I worked on with this awesome team that includes some external collaborators. And yeah, to summarize it maybe in one sentence, is that we try to pre-train GNNs with the 3D structure of molecules such that they can then make better predictions for molecules where we don't know the 3D structure as well. Yeah, so what we will be talking about are molecular graphs. And what do I mean by that? Just that we represent our molecule as a graph where the atoms are the nodes and atomic bonds are the edges of the graph. And that's what I'm going to call the 2D information of the graph, or the 2D information of the molecule. And on the other side, we have the 3D information, the conformers of the molecule, where we're just talking about really the individual 3D coordinates of the atoms. And there actually for a single molecule, we can have multiple different 3D conformers that can occur in nature and that can have a different probability of occurring in nature. And then if we have like just the 2D information of a molecule and we want to predict some properties of it, like some quantum mechanical properties maybe, or some properties from medicine, like how toxic a drug is in certain situations, then we can use GNNs to operate on this molecular graph, on this 2D information, and get some pretty good property predictions and predict them pretty accurately. But we also know that if instead of just using the 2D information, we additionally use the 3D information with something I'm going to call 3D GNNs, then we can get much better property predictions. And like these 3D GNNs are something like the directional message passing or equivalent graph neural networks or circle message passing, in case you know one of those. Yeah, and so if we include 3D information as additional input, we can get much better property predictions for many properties. And we know that the 3D information is really valuable to inform our property predictions. But now, what is our setting? Well, we have a few molecules for which we know the 3D information, but for a lot of other molecules, there are also a lot of molecules for which we don't know the 3D information. And maybe those are exactly the ones for which we want to predict the properties. And one way that we could still leverage 3D information to get more accurate property predictions would be that we take our the 2D information of our molecules and we use some classical methods, some classical statistical methods to search through possible conformations by like rotating around bonds and coming up with different conformations. And then we calculate the energy of these conformations. And if they have a low energy, they are likely to occur in nature. And this way we come up with some different possible conformers. And we maybe take the lowest energy conformer, use it as an input to one of those 3D GNNs, and we get our much better property predictions, which we know would be better. But the problem is that these classical methods to generate the 3D information, these are often too slow for real world applications, or maybe for some larger molecules, even completely infeasible. So another idea that we could have There's a slide missing here. Yeah, but another idea that we could have is that instead of the classical methods, we use learned methods to generate the 3D conformers. So we say, yeah, let me take my the data for which I do know the 3D information as an input, and those I use to train a network to generate conformers. So now I have a learned method to generate conformers, but the problem there is that now these the conformers that I can generate with the learned method, they are actually not as accurate as the ones that I can generate with the classical method. And the question is, how much will my 3D GNN be able to improve its predictions with these inaccurate conformers as input? And additionally, while these methods for learned conformation generation have made huge progress, especially this year, they are still sometimes too slow for many real world applications. So the solution that we come up with is that we basically say a nice idea to leverage the data for which we do know the 3D information, but we actually don't have to generate the explicit 3D information. What we can do instead is to generate some latent 3D information and use that to inform our downstream property predictions. So what we have there is some two-step method where we first pre-train a network and then we fine-tune. And during pre-training, we use the molecules for which we know the 3D structure. And there we pre-train this 2D network, which we then, and I'm going to explain this pre-training step later in detail, but during this pre-training, we want to teach our 2D network to learn to generate some latent 3D information. So intuitively to kind of gain an understanding of molecular dynamics. And after the 2D network has learned to generate some latent 2D information, we transfer its representation, its representations and its weights to then fine tune them on the molecules where we don't have the 3D information. And there, for those, we still generate our latent 3D information in our hidden representations of the 2D network. And this latent 3D information is able to inform our property predictions such that they are much more accurate. And while they are more accurate than if we were to just train the same GNN from scratch, we are still just as fast as the GNN. And we are just as fast as whatever architecture we choose to pre-train here. Just a single forward pass, right? Okay, but then let's talk about how we can actually do this pre-training, right? I said we want to teach our network to generate latent 3D information. How can we do that? Well, one straightforward idea would be to just have whatever we want to pre-train, some GNN here, and we let it predict, for example, all of the pairwise distances of the atoms in our molecule. And let it predict some explicit form of 3D information, like those distances. And that's what I'm going to call predictive methods for pre-training. So predictive pre-training methods. And then the idea is, in our hidden representations, we have to have learned, we have to have captured some 3D information to be able to then generate these distances. And we just transfer the weights of this GNN, fine-tune it, and use the latent 3D information to inform our property predictions. And that's something we do, and we will also look at some results there, but we have something that works better. So what we actually do is we come back to this drawing again, and now I'm going to explain it. Well, we have our 2D network that we want to pre-train, and we have some 3D network that just takes the 3D information as input and produces some 3D representation, some latent 3D representation. And the 2D network produces a latent 2D representation. And then we say we want those representations to be similar, right? It takes the information, the 2D information, and the 3D information of the same molecule as an input, and therefore we want those representations to be similar. And this way, the 2D network has to learn to capture some 3D information to be similar to the latent 3D vector. And the similarity could be defined by like the cosine similarity. But if we were to just use that as our objective, then we might end up just, well, the two networks could just produce a constant vector of all fives here and a constant vector of all fives here, completely ignoring what our inputs are. And then the two vectors would be the same. They would always be the same. Cosine similarity would be maximal and the objective would be solved. So that's obviously not what we want to do. And maybe the more principled approach is to maximize the mutual information between those representations. And one way to do that is with contrastive learning, which I'm going to just briefly explain here, where we have a batch of molecules, like three molecules here in our example, with the 2D information and the corresponding 3D information on the right side. Yeah, and the 2D network just generates all of the 2D representations and here all of the 3D representations. And then we say, well, a 2D representation, if it's coming from the same molecule as a 3D representation, then just as previously, on the previous slide, we want to maximize the cosine similarity. But if the 2D representations come, 2D representation comes from a different molecule than the 3D representation, then we want the cosine similarity to be low. So now if we have a constant vector of fives here and a constant vector of fives here, then we wouldn't solve this objective here and we no longer have this problem of the trivial solution. And yeah, in case you are familiar with these contrastive losses, I've written the contrastive loss that we use down here. And yeah, we can nicely optimize for this objective. But no, so well, that's something we do and it works well and we can already get good results with that, but we can improve a lot actually if we are looking at multiple conformers. So right, remember that a molecule, we don't only have to look at the lowest energy conformer. We can also look at some other conformers that maybe have a lower probability of occurring, but also carry a lot of important information. So now if we're looking at this molecule on the 2D side, let's look at all of its conformers. And in this example, well, we have two molecules with two conformers that are plausible for them. And what we do is to just generate the 2D representations again. And now we generate a 3D representation from each conformer. And this way, well, we can use the information of all of the conformers in a really straightforward way with this contrastive learning framework. If we just say, well, if the 2D representation comes from the same molecule as any of the 3D representations, then we want the similarity to be high. And again, if they come from different molecules, then we want the similarity to be low. And with this contrastive loss, we can really nicely just adapt it a little bit by summing over all of the possible conformers. Yeah, but so that's our approach, and that's what we do. And well, now would be maybe a good time for questions if something is unclear. Well, otherwise, I will get to, well, we know what this 2D network is, right? That's just what we want to pre-train. But what is this 3D network right here? That's still missing from our explanation, right? And it needs to fulfill some requirements. Because there's some requirements, like we wanted to capture the full geometry of the, like all of the relative positions of the individual atoms. We wanted to be translation invariant, rotation invariant. Why do we want that to be the case? Because, well, if we have a molecule and we rotate it in space or we shift it in space, all of its coordinates change a lot, but the properties of the molecule still stay completely the same. And we also want the latent representations produced by the 3D network, we want them to stay the same. Like, yeah, if we rotate our molecule, the latent representation should still be the same. We want our 3D network to be invariant with respect to translation and rotation invariant, but we actually don't want to be reflection invariant because molecules have a chirality. And if we, for example, have DNA, it can be winded the one way around, or it can be wound the other way around. So molecules can have a handedness. They can be left or right-handed. And depending on what kind we're looking at, they can actually also interact differently with other handed molecules and have different properties. So what we can do is to use some networks like spherical message passing or DIMENET, in case you know those, to as a 3D network. That would be one option, and also something we can try. We tried, and if you're particularly interested in that, we can look at some results for that later on as well. But what we actually found to work the best is some architecture that takes actually all of the pairwise distances as an input. So just the distances of each atom to each other atom as an input. And if we're operating on all of these distances, we capture all of the relative positions. We are translation invariant, we are rotation invariant, but we are actually, well, we are reflection invariant, so we are not reflection invariant. So that's a disadvantage of this approach, but empirically it's what we found to work the best. And yeah, we do that either with equivalent graph neural networks or with some own method that we cooked up to process all of these distances. Okay, but now we know how everything works, then let's try it. But remember, we have this pre-training step and this fine-tuning step. And during pre-training, we need some data sets with 3D information. And during fine-tuning, we have them without 3D information. And here, well, we also evaluate on some chemical, biological, and medical properties. But now let's focus on quantum mechanical properties. And we fine-tune on these two, like on QM9 right now, which is a data set that has 3D information, and you need to predict quantum mechanical properties. But now we pretend that for one half of QM9, we actually don't know the 3D information. We just imagine that. And this the same is the case for geom drugs. It's also has some quantum mechanical properties, and QMAX is also a data set of molecules where we have the 3D information. So first, let's look at some results that we get when fine-tuning on QM9, like a disjoint half of QM9, and pre-training on the first half of QM9, or this data set, or this data set. But let's look at the numbers. So first, what we can see here is the mean average error of these 8 properties of the QM9 dataset. So lower is better here. And in the first column, we have the mean average error that we get when training our GNN without any pre-training on the second half of QM. And here we have some traditional pre-training baselines. And here we have our 3D pre-training methods. And we can already see that the 3D pre-training methods are able to improve by a lot over the non-pre-trained baseline. Like here for this property, like sometimes almost 50% reduction in mean average error. And well, we can also notice that if we pre-train on this, the second disjoint half of QM9, and then we evaluate on the other half of QM9, then the improvement is the biggest. And if we pre-train on another data set that doesn't have as similar molecules, then our improvements are not as large. Well, they're only a little bit smaller, but still this makes sense, right? And but still we can see that we can generalize from this pretty different data set, GeoM Drugs, to QM9. Like we use GeoM Drugs, a completely different data set for pre-training that has large drug-like molecules. And then we fine-tune on QM9, where we only have like atoms with up to 9 molecules with up to 9 heavy atoms. So the pre-training data set and the fine-tuning data set is very different, but we still see an improvement. But now let's also briefly look at these predictive pre-training methods that I talked about in the very beginning, right? Because if they work just as well as our mutual information maximization thing, we should prefer them because they are much simpler. And here we have this thing where we just predict the distances. And down here, we have our contrastive learning approach. And we can see that the predictive pre-training sometimes even does worse than the random initialization baseline. So yeah, we really need to do our pre-training method, and the simple approach does not work as well. Okay, but then lastly, the last set of results I quickly wanted to look at is if we also evaluate on the properties of the second half of the GeoM Drugs dataset, which has these two properties. And yeah, again, we have here the random initialization baseline, and we can see how much we improve over it with the classical pre-training method, or if we do our 3D pre-training, these three 3D pre-training approaches. And again, we see if we pre-train on the same data set, well, disjoint half of the data set, then our improvements are the largest. But what I especially want to point out is that if we pre-train on QM9 and then we fine-tune on GeoM Drugs, we're still seeing these improvements. And why do I want to point that out especially? It's because we in QM9, we have these much smaller molecules and we're able to generalize to the much bigger molecules during fine-tuning. And especially because in QM9, we only have 5 different atoms. And in GeoM Drugs, we have 16 different atoms. So some of those atoms aren't ever actually seen during pre-training. So yeah, we can really say that we can also, for example, pre-train on much smaller molecules than we fine-tune. And the representations that we learn are very general because, well, 3D information apparently is just very useful for many tasks. Okay, and that's of course pretty valuable to use it in actual practice. But then I want to conclude with what we have now, or some pretty nice improvements on some molecular properties. And we also know that our representations are generalized pretty well. But then some future directions, which we think are maybe the most promising, is that, well, potentially we could combine our 3D pre-training method with conventional pre-training methods, because the advantages that we get from both, they should be, or they are disjoint, and maybe we can, yeah, have both advantages at the same time. And then another idea is to maybe, if you know GemNet, maybe we can use that as a 3D network, because that's one that we actually haven't tried yet. And then lastly, what I think to be the most promising, or like what I think is the biggest bottleneck in our method right now, is to prevent the 3D network from encoding 2D information. Because right, I said we generate a 2D representation, a 3D representation, maximize the mutual information. And because of that, the 2D network has to learn to encode 3D representation. But actually the mutual information could also be maximized if the 3D network learned to encode 2D information over here. And then we just have 2D information in both representations, and that's not so useful for our downstream property prediction. So finding a way to prevent the 3D network from encoding as much 2D information as it's maybe doing, that's maybe the best way to improve our method. Okay, but then now that you know how our method works and the whole nice improvements we can get for some properties, do you have any questions?
Yeah, I do. Thank you for the nice presentation. My first question would be, so right now you're using contrastive loss to use your metric, but there are also like various other approaches you can do, triplet loss, more advanced stuff like hard example mining, for example, when you're doing metric learning. Have you already tried anything in that direction? Do you think it would be promising to try to build on like more advanced metric learning approaches?
Yeah, well, we didn't look at every possible method, but we looked at some other methods, for example, so these three other methods, and we just tried all of them and also had some approaches for adapting them to our setting, because some of the approaches don't work for different modalities yet. Like we have this 2D and the 3D modality, and we adapted Bootstrap Your Own Latent, for example, which is a self-supervised method, or variance, invariance, covariance regularization. And the simple contrastive learning approach was actually what worked the best. But yeah, maybe there are also other metric learning approaches that we should try instead, and then might work better.
Okay, that's nice to see that you've already looked into that. Another thing, earlier on you said that you were like feeding multiple possible like foldings, or what was it called?
Conformers? Yeah.
Into the model. Usually, like, I don't know a lot of about chemistry, but usually there's like one correct folding, right? Like one that minimizes the energy or something.
Yeah. Proteins. So say we're looking at this molecule, this one right here, then we could have, like, I don't know the exact numbers for this specific molecule, but it could be that this conformer, like the conformer one, that occurs in nature, like it has the lowest energy of all of the conformers, and it occurs in nature with a probability of 0.6. And the other one occurs with a probability of 0.39. And then maybe there's some other completely improbable conformers that also occur. But yeah, maybe often the distribution looks like that we have 0.9 and 0.5 for the probabilities of them occurring, but sometimes we also have a very, sometimes we also have 0.3, 0.2 and so on. And a molecule has like 10 conformers that are all very likely. So yeah, there's not always just one conformer that really has all of the or most of the probability. And some molecules also have 1,000 conformers. And these actually are also in these data sets, like not in QM9 actually as well.
Okay. Yeah. I think it could potentially still be interesting to see what happens when you like feed the best conformer, so the lowest energy conformer, or actually like weigh it based on how likely it is or how low its energy level is.
Okay. Then let's have a look at those results. We're looking at what happens if we use a single conformer. If we use our best approach for using, that's the one that I explained, the best approach for using multiple conformers, or this Boltzmann sampling. In that approach, we weight the different conformers by their probability. Yeah, and over here on the, here we're predicting the properties of QM9, and here we're predicting the properties of GEOM drugs, and here we're pre-training with GEOM drugs, like with the disjoint half of GEOM drugs, and here we're pre-training with QMAX. And yeah, we can, over here the differences aren't so big for the different pre-training methods, but here for QMAX, for example, we can see if we use only a single conformer, then we sometimes like get almost no improvement at all. And then if we use all of the conformers with our method, then we get the full advantage.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
And actually all of the results where we that I showed, where we pre-train on QM9 and fine-tune on QM9, like this column right here, there we only use the highest energy, the lowest energy conformer. So this is always with a single conformer. Here we use 5, and here we use 3, the 3 lowest energy conformers. But yeah, that's like a really important aspect of our findings, I would say, with these multiple conformers. So thanks for the question.
Hi, thank you for a great presentation. I have a question. Did you feel, since you're predicting essentially a single like energy value, for example, like if you work with QM9 for a whole set of conformers, have you thought about like, okay, despite the fact that QM9 doesn't include conformers, I think, like only one, like this only single 3D structure per molecule. But did you thought about like predicting a distribution of energies or properties for the conformers? Like what sensible ranges are, or like limits, like a minimum and maximum energy for a given molecule, for where all the conformers lie in, or something like that?
Well, right, the situation that we're assuming is that where our method is valuable is if we don't have the 3D information for the molecules where we want to make the predictions. And so we don't actually know different 3D conformers for the molecules for which we want to make predictions and don't have different conformers there. And only during this pre-training step are we regarding different conformers. Do you know what I mean?
I think I understand what you mean. Like, but isn't there still a way to like output a prediction, for example, like a mean and a standard deviation or something, and like have these multiple conformers inform you, because like if you go to like slide 9 or so, where you match your 2D representation, like the 2D representation as it represents the 2D network with the representation of the 3D network, like if you now imagine you have 10 conformers, I think the easiest matching would be if the 10 conformers just predict only to like only output information based on the 2D graph, because you force them to essentially have the same output, right?
So are you referring to a problem that like these representations could end up being all the same as like
right
yeah, that these representations end up being all the same even though we have the different conformers here?
Right, and then you essentially only work on the 2D graph because you lose the information, because if you have too many conformers, you essentially like you have to mean over them, and then you only have the 2D graph.
What you could do there, right, for example, is that we generate another 2D representation here, and like for each conformer we generate multiple 2D representations, and then we match them up, like we match the 2D representations up and find the ones that fit the best. Is that something that you think would solve this problem?
I guess could be one potential like solution, I guess.
Yeah, then let's.
Yeah, I was just curious, because essentially you're compressing multiple conformers to one, and like in the best case, you can also in the end reconstruct like a distribution as you got in, you get.
Yeah, that's what we're doing with this similarity all. So let's say these are our 2D, our 2D representations here, and our 3D representations over here. With this similarity all loss, what we're doing here is to like now these are the 3D and 2D representations coming from the same molecule, right? These are our three conformers, and our single molecule produced these three 2D representations. And then we match them up to be, yeah, we look at the similarities between all of them and want all of them to be high. That's what we do in this similarity all setting. And with the similarity max, we find the matching between the 2D representation and 3D representations that provide the lowest loss. And yeah, that actually works pretty well as well. Like, okay, not just as well as the multi 3D setting, but yeah, we also tried these approaches and started looking into some optimal transport losses between the 3D and 2D representations. But well, empirically, the fancy stuff didn't work as well as the straightforward stuff.
Okay, thank you.
But yeah, I mean, that's exactly the right question. Right? It's really cool how you're having exactly the same thoughts as we had during the project. Okay.
Okay, so I think if there is no more question, thanks a lot again for the great presentation. And I don't think there is another presentation today. So thank you everyone for joining today, and see you next week.
Then I want to say thank you for the awesome questions, and see you next week as well.
Thanks, bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.